Well, hi there. This is Blair Hill with ConnectAutism.org, autism education by people with autism. We want to have you see autism from the inside out. Today we're going to talk about a very crucial subject, how to motivate someone with Aspergers or high functioning autism. And we're going to talk about 3 points today, and I'm going to teach backwards and show you the 3 points: obstacles to motivation, understanding motivation, and the keys to motivation, or these will be the actual answers and solutions to the problem. One of the things I'm asked by parents all the time is, how do I get my child with autism to do this, do a certain task? Or they'll many times say that their child refuses to do the tasks. And as a parent with 2 kids with autism, my wife and I both have been diagnosed with high functioning autism. And we have 2 kids, a 12-year-old girl, Miriam, and an 18-year-old young man, Caleb, who are both diagnosed with high functioning autism. So we've raised and are raising 2 kids with autism. So we work with work refusal a lot. And one of our first obstacles to motivation and some of the problems we have, you have to understand where someone with autism is coming from. Behavior is communication. So if there's a certain type of behavior, we said this again and again, and we'll refer to it in future series because it's very important. When you see a certain behavior, if you can understand the reasoning behind that, they're actually communicating through that behavior. Now, another thing is with the obstacles to motivation is individuals with autism are very, very logical thinkers. They're very logical, and many times they'll get stuck on a certain subject. Their brain is going and it'll click like a computer and it'll lock up on this one segment, and they can't get off of that idea. They get locked in, and they may not be able to articulate what exactly they want because this one thing is locked into their brain. If you think about just basic needs, one of our kids, they both struggle with being thirsty and knowing when to drink water. Well, it's like, well, everybody knows when they're thirsty. Well, someone with autism, this is how they think. My throat is dry. I feel hot. Something's wrong with my stomach. I feel kind of lightheaded. I feel something. What is it? And they won't realize that their instinct for thirst is rising up within them. So we'll have to remind them again and again about drinking. This is how the mind of someone with autism works, is their brain doesn't always connect with what they're feeling. And a lot of times they'll get stuck on a certain word and they'll lock up on that certain concept. And it's like taking a crowbar to trying to pry them out of there. And sometimes there's just a lockup in the brain, a hard drive that locks up and you can't start it. It's like a hard drive that just locked. This is an obstacle to motivation, because if the brain is locked up, it won't function. You can't teach someone when their brain is locked up. Another thing is, if someone with high functioning autism or Asperger's is experiencing a lot of frustration or stress or anxiety, their brain function actually lowers. It's proven science that as their stressors come and as the anxiety rises, the brain functioning slows down or even stops. So this is one of the problems. You need to work on lowering their anxiety before you can start to motivate them. One of the obstacles to motivation. Another way is to ask questions. To ask a question instead of making a demand. If you make a demand, there's more of a tendency for their brain of our kids to lock up. And this is one of the ways you can get around that. Another problem is transitions, an obstacle to motivation. There's such a difficulty for individuals with ASD to transition into something new, to move from the house to the car. This has been the biggest battle for us. The hardest thing is to get out of the house. So we've set together techniques and keys, which we'll talk about a little later, to getting through this. But one of the things you can do is give them several warnings. We're going to be leaving in 15 minutes. We're going to be leaving in 10 minutes. We're going to be leaving in 5 minutes. We're going to be leaving in 2 minutes. This helps a lot. Also, if you tell them when you're going to finish something, they're always thinking ahead. They're always processing several steps ahead of you. Or like the neuropsychologist told us that our daughter, she's always going to be smarter than you are. Well, I know what he was saying. He was saying that she thinks so many steps ahead of the time. And so if you, that's because of their anxiety. They want to know what's coming. So they think, what's next? What's next? It's the story about the cat is going to a party. And the question the cat asks is, will there be any dogs there? Really, how much anxiety am I going to have if I go to this place? So if you tell them ahead of time what you're doing, you're going to de-escalate a lot of problems that you're going to have. Okay, another obstacle to motivation is the concept of time. And if you can overcome some of these obstacles, you'll begin to motivate someone to do specific tasks with autism. Our kids have no clock. They have no internal clock. Those children that have high-functioning autism, they're very slow at getting to appointments, and they're usually late because appointments don't mean anything to them. We're going someplace. Why do I have to be there at a certain time? The concept of time and time management is just not part of their DNA. you need to set up some motivational things. One of the things that can help too, besides the giving them a countdown, is to use a timer. And so, even sometimes you can purchase a digital timer which has a countdown face on it. You can see the time evaporating away. And this will help them to get a concept of time. Another thing I'd like to talk about right now that has a blockage to motivation is how we do therapy with individuals with autism. A lot of times with ABA therapy, and I'm not against ABA therapy or any therapies or anything that'll help, but we have to look at how does a young person, how do your kids think if they have autism? Now I can tell you how they think because I have autism and I know how my brain works and I know what's going through their heads. And this is why I have a passion to educate, because I want you to understand as parents, or if you're working with someone with autism, how those children think. And if you know how they think, then you can motivate them, because until you get them motivated, there's going to be no growth, there's going to be very little learning, the social skills will not become, they will not grow in social skills until you get the motivation. So my passion is to help people understand. And a lot of things with autism treatment is if we're thinking about image. Hollywood is all about image. The most beautiful people, the most beautiful image, everything on the screen has to be perfect. And we know that's not real life. Sometimes we are addicted to this perfect image. And sometimes as parents, we want our children to be perfect. We want them to be beautiful. We want them to be successful like everyone else's, standardized. We have to get past that. It's not so much trying to change everything about the person with autism. We need to make changes where we can. But this is the perception. You can't push. You know, it comes back to education. If you understand where the person is coming from, you can help to motivate them. So obstacles to motivation. We're going to move on to number two. Yes, that's number two. Is understanding motivation. How can we understand it? We have obstacles that stop it, but now how do we understand motivation with someone that has Asperger's? Before you can really motivate someone with high-functioning autism to do a certain specific task, you must understand what is their preferred way of communication. Understanding motivation with someone with autism. Understand how they communicate. How do they communicate? A lot of times I explain it to, I speak Chinese, you speak English. How well do you think we'll be able to communicate? Not very good. Well, someone with Asperger's speaks Chinese and the neurotypical world speaks English. So you have to learn how to speak their language so they can understand. There's a whole series out there too about for marriages and relationships called love language. What is your love language? What type of language communicates love to you? To some people, you give them gifts and serve them and do tasks for them, and that motivates them. To some people, that doesn't show a love. That's not their love language. Their love language may be they need to hear someone say a word to them. There's different types of way we communicate love to people. There's different types of way we communicate to different people, especially those on the spectrum. So if you learn to speak autism Chinese, you're going to be able to communicate to your children a lot better. My wife and I have developed strategies ourselves, because we understand autism, to motivate our kids to grow and to help them lower their anxiety. And you can lower a person with autism's anxiety. And one of the ways is to alleviate some of these behaviors is to realize how valuable they are as a person. You know, how valuable they are. You're not, the person with autism is not broken. They don't need to be changed completely and turned into a neurotypical person. They need to be understood and they need to be loved. We need to have more understanding and tolerance for people with autism. If you understand how they think and how they communicate and you take the effort to try to learn that, you're going to get a long ways ahead on the road of understanding motivation. The world really needs to change. The world needs to change its perception of people with autism. You know, it seems like we're trying to normalize autism and make them to act like neurotypicals. You know, I came up with a word and I thought we're always trying to de-autism them. De-autism. Dis-autism, take the autism out of them, so they'll be normal like the rest of the world. This is how a person with autism was created. You know, this is how they were meant to be with autism. And they have many, many different gifts that they can offer the world. So you understand how the mind thinks. Understand that you have to connect with somebody with autism first. In order for a therapist, and this is for therapists and teachers, to understand autism, you have to be able to connect with that person. You have to really care. Sometimes it looks like someone with autism, high functioning autism, doesn't care. It's just they can't express their feelings always. They care and they understand what's going on. They see when people are dissing them, or people are being negative or aren't really accepting them. And with a therapist, a professional, a teacher, you need to really care about this person. You need to really want to see them grow. And this connection is going to release them to be motivated so they can start learning. Okay, understanding motivation. We want to really understand. I want to tell you a little story about understanding. There was a girl that we read about that had a stemming problem. She'd be slapping her throat all the time. And it was so irritating to the people around her. And she kept slapping her throat. And they couldn't figure out why she always slapped her throat. And she was a nonverbal, lower functioning autism. And they took her to the doctor and they found out that she had a throat condition. That she didn't have a lining on the inside of her throat. So every time she swallowed or spit or ate, it would hurt or drank, and she would pat it to try to calm it. Now, if someone would have tried to stop this behavior, oh, let's just modify their behavior and stop this behavior, stop this. Well, that was something that she was using to calm herself. So we have to look at what's socially acceptable and what is really socially acceptable. I mean, who makes up these rules of what's socially acceptable? If you have to clap a little bit to calm yourself down rather than have a meltdown, then the world should accept that a little bit. So this is the point I'm trying to make. All right. We have to be understanding and be flexible. Understanding motivation. Now here is the keys to motivation. Some of the keys that my wife and I have learned of all our years of living with autism and raising two kids. Sometimes our kids seem like they're solid as a rock. It's like the rock of Gibraltar. They're just solid as a rock. A bulldozer couldn't move them out of their position. How many know what I'm talking about? Okay, so we have to find out, how do we get them unstuck when they're stuck, when they're like a solid rock? One of the ways is rewards, or sometimes it could be called bribes. Now, in the political realm, bribes are not good. You can be arrested in many professions for bribes, but this is where bribes are good. Reward systems. What's their favorite food? What's their favorite video game to have a few extra minutes to play? Some money of a reward. Find out what motivates your kids and give them a reward. It's like a carrot on a stick. And you put that carrot out there and there's something to motivate them. If they don't have a motivation for the activity or the task, they're probably not going to do it unless there's some kind of motivation. So our job is to understand how to motivate them. Another thing is choice. Instead of making demands and pushing them, because people with autism, the more you push them, the more they fight back. And the more they fight back, the more you start pushing them, and you start pushing. Pretty soon it's back and forth, arguing, meltdown, people are crying, they're stomping on the floor, they're slamming doors, and we have a mess. But if you understand what is it is their passion, what motivates them, use that to direct them. Also, give them a choice. Would you like to sweep the floor or clean the sink in your bathroom? Don't say, go do this. Say, would you rather do this or do this? Ask a question. It de-escalates it. It's actually an oppositional defiance disorder technique. Because really when they're locked up, it's almost like an oppositional thing going on there. And in their brains, they're locked. So you need to figure out a way to pry that thing open by coming at it at a different angle. So choices. Give them a choice. Do you want to do this? Do you want to do that? Would you like to do your math first, homework, or would you like to do your science first? And it's like, hey, I have a choice. I'm empowered. Now they're empowered. Now they're motivated. Very interesting. And it just really, they think logically. It's like for all the Star Trek Trekkies, if you think of Spock in the old Star Trek series, he would always say, your emotional response is not logical. And they're not. They're not logical. They don't respond so much emotionally. They respond by logic. And if you can understand that telling them and teaching them logical and taking steps and giving them choices, this is a logical thing. They get to logically decide which is which. And their black and white brain, their lateral brain, give them a choice. Here's another coping skill that my wife and I have learned to help in many different areas. Another key is scripts. Now, what do I mean by scripts? You want me to become an actor and be in a play? No, these are scripts for life. And a lot of times people with autism are very good at memorizing facts and figures or steps. So one of the things you could do is create scripts for when you're going to go meet somebody. What do you say? There's three things you say. You say hello, you shake their hand, you ask them about their job, you ask them about their favorite subject. You just have these, and this is what I use. I have a set script that I ask new people. Otherwise, my brain lots of times will lock up with anxiety, and I can't speak anymore. So, use scripts. A lot of different scripts to help you navigate life. Think of what's going to happen and then write a simple script of 3 points that you memorize, and when you go in that situation, you just read your list. And we're good at reading lists. People with autism are good at looking at their list or looking at the procedure. This is a very, very good key to motivation. And once you release that blockage, the person with autism will start learning. They're going to start opening up. They're going to start wanting to complete their task. So that's what we want you to do. We want to educate. We want to entertain. We want to do things in a fun way. So we're talking again about autism motivation, obstacles of motivation, understanding motivation, and keys to motivation. There are very helpful keys for you to use. You just need to practice them and put them to work, and you will see changes in your young person. You will see things start to work more smoothly. So have a great day. Again, this is Blair Hill with ConnectAutism.org and our Autism Transformation Series. Thanks for stopping and being with us today.